ever bless, wellspring of the joy of living, ocean depth of happy rest. Thou our Father, Christ our brother, all who live in love are thine. Teach us how to love each other, lift us to the joy divine. Mortals, join the mighty chorus which the morning stars began. The divine is reigning o'er us, leading us with mercy's hand. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph.
Can tell it's fall. Plenty of leaf dust around the air. Oh, how I love Jesus.
There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its word. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfectly. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells me what my Father has in store for every day. And though I tread a darksome path, he'll sunshine all the way. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first
You may be seated.
Good evening, church. It's good to be back with y'all tonight. Let me ask you to take your Bibles, if you would. Turn to the book of Acts, chapter 8. Tonight we'll be looking at Acts, chapter 8, verses 26 through 40 this evening. This morning as we were taking a look at that message, one of the illustrations that I shared with you was about a Wycliffe Bible translator, some of the Wycliffe Bible translators back in the turn of the century who were in the process of going overseas, and what they did because of the dangers of going on the mission field in those days, and even today, they packed, instead of packing a crate with put all their stuff in it, they used a coffin, literally to carry their stuff because cholera or dysentery or even the natives they may go among might decide to kill and take their lives. You know, I think we ought to always have that type of a mindset as like missionaries, is to have our coffin packed, have a very light hold on these days. I don't know about y'all, but I enjoy my stuff. Anybody else like your stuff, your things? Yeah. Yes, no, yes. So You had your push lawnmower back in the day. Now you got your zero turn mower, right? Right. And back in the day, you had a garden hose. Now you got a power washer. All that stuff, we hang on to it. We think it does us well until things change. And maybe your health disappears or somebody you know you love dies. And the perspective changes, doesn't it? You realize the value of those things is really, some of them really don't have value. And you begin to look at what's most important. Here in the book of Acts, I want to talk to you about the ends of the earth, about being a people who carry the gospel to the ends of the earth and having that same type of mindset, especially in these days, and how vital and important that it is. Look with me, Acts chapter 8. We're looking at verse 26 through 40 tonight. It's a story about the gospel being carried to the world. It starts in verse number 26 and says this, "And now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, Arise and go toward the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert. So he arose and went." Now, if we just stop right there, let me just kind of chase a rabbit here for a minute. If we just did that, what God asked us to do, and he arose and went, we wouldn't even have to worry about the other passages and breaking them down and looking at them. If we just did what Philip did when God told him to go, guess what Philip did? He went. He didn't say, "Well, Lord, you need to understand, I've got a calendar that's got some dates on it, and I've got some things coming up. The kids have got some games they need to be to, and I've got a really important meeting at the office. I'll get around to following you as soon as I get these things done. Is that okay?" No, it says in verse 27, he arose and went. The scripture simply says this, obedience is better than sacrifice. Obedience is better than sacrifice. He arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasury and had come to Jerusalem to do what, church? To worship. He was returning and sitting in his chariot, and he was reading Isaiah the prophet. He was reading the Bible. He was reading the scroll. And in verse 29, it goes on to say, "And then the Spirit said to Philip, Go near and overtake his chariot. So Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah." He must have been reading out loud. "And said, Do you understand what you're reading? And he said, How can I unless someone guides me? And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him. The place in the scripture which he read was this." Listen to this from Isaiah. "He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, his justice was taken away. And all who declare who will declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth." Verse 34, "So the eunuch answered Philip and said, I ask you, of whom does the prophet say this? Of himself or some other man? And then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning at this scripture, preached Jesus to him." In Isaiah chapter 53, he started at this place and preached Jesus to him, right where he was at that very moment. "Now as they went down the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, See, here is water, and what hinders me from being baptized? Then Philip said, If you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So he commanded the chariot to stand still, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he baptized him. Now when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away, so that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way doing what? He went on his way doing what? When y'all first said, y'all said rejoicing. This man just got saved. He just got baptized. He went on his way. Guess what he was doing? He was rejoicing. Rejoicing. But Philip, verse 40, was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea. I want to talk to you tonight about the ends of the earth, to the ends of the earth, and ways to expand the kingdom of God as we carry it to the ends of the earth. First, it is this, that the kingdom is expanded by obeying God's command to go. Simple, elementary truth here in a good Baptist church tonight, but we always need to be reminded of the most important thing. because we forget. And if you don't believe me, you can go to most Baptist churches, and sometimes they'll have a table that says on the Lord's Supper table, as often as you do this, you do this in, because we forget. Because we do, we need to remember the great price that was paid by the Lord Jesus Christ for our redemption, what God was willing to do to set things right so that we could have forever fellowship with Him. So in these passages, we see that the kingdom is expanded by obeying God's command to go. It not only was said to Philip, but it is said to all the way across the ages to us even here tonight. And now the angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, verse 26, saying, "Arise and go toward the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert." And he arose and went. And behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority, under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasury and had come to Jerusalem to worship, was returning and sitting in his chariot. He was reading Isaiah the prophet, and the Spirit said to Philip, "Go near and overtake his chariot." William Carey is the father of modern missions. He served in India. In 1792, he organized a missionary society, and at its inauguration meeting, preached a sermon with the call, "Expect great things from God, attempt great things for God." He translated the Bible, the entire Bible, into India's major language, which is Hindu. He also sought social reform in India, including abolition of infanticide, widow burning, and assisted suicide. His greatest legacy was in worldwide missionary movement of the 19th century that he inspired. And when he heard the verses, "Arise and go," William Carey arose and went, and we are on the wave of his obedience. We ride the wave of his obedience of carrying the gospel to the world. And I believe in these days that we ought to be a people of obedience like Philip. When God tells us to arise and go, regardless of our circumstances, we ought to arise and go. And somebody might say, "Hey, hold on. God's calling us to go to a desert." That's what he did here with Philip. Said, "This is desert." And he didn't argue with God. He just said, "Lord, do you know there's not any water in the desert, and it's hot in the day and cold in the evening, and there's cactus and lizards and weird stuff in the desert. Nothing." He just obeyed God. And we can always bring up excuses. We can always bring up reasons. "I'm too old. I don't know enough Bible. I'm really not very articulate. I'm not outgoing." Fill in the blank. They're all excuses. You see none given here by Philip. He arose in obedience, and he went, and in doing so, the kingdom of God was expanded. For in Africa, in Ethiopia, there Candace, who was in charge of the treasury, sent one of her men in authority, a eunuch, back to Jerusalem to worship with the people of Jerusalem there. And what he took back with him when he went back to Ethiopia was the gospel of Jesus Christ. He bore it with him back to Africa because Philip was willing to obey what God had said to him. Folks, in Union County, there are over 30 different languages spoken in this county. Mecklenburg County, 150. It's over 300 languages. I was corrected the other day by that. 300 dialects spoken in Mecklenburg County. That means this. The world has come to us. The world has come to us. And so if the Lord were to tell you, you need to take the kingdom of God to the folks that are even right here so they may carry the gospel back to their own nations, we ought to rise up and go. If you go down over here on Highway 218, Christ Baptist Church, one of the churches in our association, it'll be on the right as you're headed towards Charlotte. You know there's a roundabout there now. And off to the right is a weird little small house complex with some grapevines there. If you're going up the road, there's a soccer field on the left. And that soccer field, every Sunday, they're playing cricket. And the guys that are playing cricket are from India. If you speak English, if you drink tea, and you play cricket, you probably have some type of English colonization in your blood. And that's exactly what's happening on 218. These guys are from India. It's called the Carolina Cricket Association. These guys are from India, and they go out there every Sunday, and they play cricket. What's that got to do with anything? Well, if Jesus says proclaim the gospel into all the world, what's wrong with us getting some guys that know how to play baseball and go up there and say, you mind if we watch you play cricket? And learn how to play cricket. And meet these guys and say, would you teach us how to play cricket? And maybe go up there and cook some hot dogs or something weird that they eat in India or something. Bring some food that they would eat and have a cookout. And maybe invite them to our church and to teach some of our folks in our church how to play cricket. Sports is the universal language, is it not? And in that, show the love of Jesus Christ and tell them about the true Christ. When I was in the India, I was riding in one of these little rickshaw things. It was in the evening. We went past a cemetery, and I remember one of the guys from India. There was a Muslim shrine that was there in the graveyard, and I remember him doing this ascent paying homage to that as we drove past. And I said, "Why did you do that? Why did you pay homage to a Muslim shrine, and you're being Hindu?" He said, "In case that's where the true God was." I call that an open door. I said, if I knew who the true God was, would you like to know? And so as we drove up through the back roads of Delhi, I shared the good news of Jesus Christ, of who the true God was. Those moments are here. Those roads into the desert where the Ethiopian eunuch are here. They are among us now. And they don't even have to be from another country. They can be our friends and our families as well, too. And folks, we must be proclaimers of the gospel. It must be now. Christ's approach is soon. And if he tarries, that person, that individual, if you never share the gospel, they will die one day and step off into a Christless eternity and be judged and found weighing in the scales of Christ lacking and be forever condemned to the fires of hell. And you great ambassador of God, you modern day Philip, have the great privilege to run into the desert and to go the places God calls you to go and find those defining moments where people are being drawn by the Spirit of God and proclaim the unsearchable riches of Christ that has been raised from the dead. Being your DOM, one of the things I have to do a lot is eat. The easiest way to get one-on-one time with a preacher is to take him out to lunch. So I do that quite often. I was with a pastor, associate pastor, the other day. We were having lunch. We were talking. And our waitress, as she was serving us, I said, will you normally pray over our meal? Is there anything we can pray for you about? You know, she has her little mask on, and she just kind of caught her off guard, and she wasn't sure. She thought, and she said, really, everything. And I could tell she was starting getting a little emotional. I said, well, by the way, what's your name? She said, my name's Grace. I said, Grace, that's a really pretty name. Do you know what that means? And I began to explain to her about grace, God's unmerited favor, and how what Christ did on our behalf. She had never heard the gospel. And she just began to cry. Because she was without life. She was without Christ. And folks, those people are everywhere. They're riding into Jerusalem, coming to worship the God they've never even met. They're here in our country. They're here in our state. They're here in our county. They're your friends. They're your family. You work with him. You will rub elbows with them all week long. And it is high time that you, the church, should rise up being the ambassadors of Christ and recognize that the kingdom of God stands before you, and all you must do is speak. Speak from your heart the gospel message. You say, well, preacher, I've never done that before. Well, there's always the first time. No time like the present. If everybody in here between now and the end of the year share the gospel with one person, it would be about 40 people would hear the gospel between now and the end of the year from this church. And what if 10% of them got saved? Four people. You see my math calculator working right there? Maybe not four people, maybe that's four families. where the gospel has dispelled the darkness and brought people from death to life and brought transformation and maybe brought into a home love and peace and grace where there was never that before. You have that power. You have that ability. You have that privilege. You can be the William Careys of today. You should arise and go. Go and overtake the chariots that are before you. Listen to the voice of God as He speaks to you. For these days are defining. They will define our future. They will define your church. They will define your life and how much glory you bring God. Rise up, church, and be the kingdom of God through obedience. Secondly, we see the kingdom is expanded by obeying God's command to proclaim the gospel, verses 30 through 35. So Philip ran to him because the Lord told him to go overtake the chariot, and he ran to him. When was the last time we ran to carry the gospel to somebody? And he heard him reading the prophet Isaiah. So here's Philip. He's running beside the chariot. He's listening to this guy over the clippity-clop of the horse. Philip must have been a young guy. Can I get an amen from somebody? At what point do we stop running? 40? 42? You understand where I'm at. Philip's running. And he hears this man reading something. And because Philip's a good Hebrew, a good Jewish boy, he realizes from the book of Isaiah, which we'll look at here in just a minute. He hears him reading. Do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I unless someone guides me? And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him. And the place in the scripture which he read was this. So the chariot stops. Philip gets in. He begins to point to the scroll, and he says, here it is. He was led as a sheep to the slaughter. This is the Old Testament. This is Isaiah. This is prophecy. This is prophesying of the one that would come, and he's already come, and he's already gone to the cross, and he's already been raised from the dead. And the hubbub of that is going around the world. It's left Jerusalem. It's going into Judea and Samaria and the worlds, and here it's being in the desert, passed on to an Ethiopian. Here he hears that this one that has come to Jerusalem, the God-man, was led as a sheep to the slaughter. As a lamb before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. And in his humiliation, his justice was taken away. Who will declare his generation? Midway, who in this place will declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. Verse 34, so the eunuch answered Philip and said, I ask you, of whom does the prophet say this, of himself or some other man? And Philip opened his mouth when Christ did not open his. And beginning at this scripture in Isaiah, preached Jesus to him. The kingdom of God is expanded by obeying God's command to proclaim the gospel. And you're going to run into people in all kinds of situations, in all kinds of places. And I admonish you, where they are, speak about Christ. You don't need to get them to church, and you don't need to get them in a suit, and you don't need to get them cleaned up and get them in Sunday school and get them coming and tithing before you ever share the gospel. Maybe it is because their life is turned upside down. Maybe their relationships are broken. Maybe their health is broken. Maybe their finances are broken. Maybe they're none of those things, and maybe the Spirit of God has them in a chariot reading Isaiah out loud on the desert road going home. Start there. With where God places you, start there in that moment and preach Jesus Christ to them. I remember going to Cuba with Antioch Baptist Church a couple years ago. We found ourselves down on one of the beaches, beautiful beaches there in Cuba. And the house church we were at was not too far from there, so we went down there to take a break. A lot of the Cubans come down there for the weekends, And I knew that a lot of the ladies that were on our trip had gone down there, so I wanted to check on, make sure they were okay. And when I went down there, I noticed that there was a Cuban guy that was there that was kind of flirting with them to the degree they seemed to be a little uncomfortable. And I could tell he had been imbibing. Matter of fact, he was drunk. And I thought, well, they need a little help, so I'm going to go down there and help them. So I went down there and got in between him and the girls, and I didn't speak very good Spanish, and he didn't speak very good English. And I could tell he was getting pretty mad because he thought I was moving in on his women. He didn't realize I was standing in between him and our ladies because they were a little uncomfortable with it. So I reached over and grabbed the interpreter because he was not happy, and he was giving me what for. And I said, what's he saying? He said, he wants to know why you're in his country. I said, well, thank you for the question. It's a good question. I've came here to tell you how much God loves you. And big crocodile tears welled up in his eyes, and he stopped talking. And he just began to weep. And he fell down in the sand on his knees, and I got down there with him and reached up and got the interpreter and brought them down there with me. And at that moment where I was, in that awkward moment, I began to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with this man, and he trusted Christ as Lord and Savior. I looked over at his drinking buddies, and they were all going, yeah, you do a good job. They didn't even know what I was doing, but they were tired of him. He was just one of them crazy drunks. You understand? Because some of y'all might have been one at one point. It was that moment he rose up sober and saved. And as we went back to the house, he followed with us, weeping and imploring that he could come with us. And I said, brother, you got to go back with your friends through an interpreter. You got to go back with your friends or you're going to end up sleeping on the beach tonight. And he reminded me of the man in the cemetery that Christ went and exercised all the demons out of that had a legion of demons in him. He wanted to go with Jesus, but he said, stay. Go tell your people. And that's basically what we told this. Go back, tell your friends what's happened to you. You can't come with us. You need to go back there. Where the man was, I could have told him, look, hey, come to the church tonight, clean up, sober up, come on to church. We'll be glad to have you. Instead of right there on that beach in that moment, sharing the gospel. I remember being at the bus stop there in the same place, Cuba, where the gospel runs with great strength. There we were getting ready to leave. I was tired. I walked to every barrio. I felt like at Cuba I had to walk in and talk to people and share the gospel. I was exhausted, and I was going to have to ride in the back of a truck for a half hour to get back, just ready to go. And it looked like there were some guys at the bus stop that were behind us. Looked like they were MS-13 to me. And the Spirit of the Lord said, go back there and witness to them. I said, Lord, they look like MS-13 back there. I'm tired. I'm hungry. So I started asking around, who's got Bibles? Scrounged up a few Bibles, and I went back there with the interpreter. I've never seen young men so hungry to hear the gospel in my life. As respectful as these men were, they began to call their friends up, and I was like, oh, no, I'm in trouble now. They called their friends up to hear what I was telling them. And these guys began, they got saved, and we just left them with Bibles. You thought we'd have given them thousands of dollars the way that they thanked us and clung to the Word of God. They're in the city because we were out in the barrio, out in the neighborhoods. In the city, the pastor that we went with got in trouble because he drew a crowd of so many people from the apartment complex that wanted to hear the gospel that the communists that were there, these minders, got upset and they made them leave. He didn't invite them to a church. He went to where they were. And that's what we need to do like Philip did here, to be a people who expand the kingdom of God by proclaiming the gospel wherever God places us. Luke says this in verse chapter 24, and he said to them, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and entered into his glory? And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. This was words that Jesus spoke on the road to Emmaus to men who didn't understand the Christ who was raised from the dead. And as he walked with them, he started in the Old Testament, and he began to explain about himself. How glorious a gospel presentation is that? Then the God of the universe, the Lamb that was slain from the foundations of the world, God in flesh himself, walks with you on the road to Emmaus back home and explains to you who he is. And you have been given the seal of the Spirit and the role of being an ambassador to hold forth and proclaim the unsearchable riches of the good news of Jesus Christ. I remember being in Slovakia, my first mission trip I ever went on when I was in seminary. I was scared, didn't know what to do, wasn't sure about the people, the culture. It was all weird to me. And all they did was feed us cabbage and rice, cabbage and rice. I was tired of cabbage and rice. And I met Vladimir Shatesky. I was 35 years old, 33 years old, and Vladimir was in his 60s, and he looked at me like I was strange, like I had three eyes. And he was to be my interpreter that week, and he wasn't much on evangelizing, and we went down on the square in a nation that had just come out of communism from 8 years. We began to share the good news of Jesus Christ, and he wasn't too sure about that. And then we started seeing people get saved. All week long, me and Vlad, 30-some years my senior, began to share the gospel with skinheads, with military guys, anybody that would listen. We shared the gospel. We saw so many military guys get saved. We shared it with one guy. I told him about the gospel, and he got saved. We said, now go tell everybody on the bus when you're going back to the base. And the next day, here he come with about 30 guys, all in uniform. I thought, uh-oh, Vlad, we're in trouble. And that guy got around us. He said, tell them what you told me yesterday. And we told all those military guys, about 8 of them got saved. We watched that go on and on and on. So the last day, we went back down on the square to meet all our interpreters. And I had about all the cabbage and rice I could take, and I was had some jet lag going on. I was just ready to go home. So I sat down on the bench. And off in the distance was Vlad. Eric, come. Perhaps we can share Jesus with this one. Come, perhaps we can share Jesus with this one. I said, Vlad, I'm just going to sit here for a little bit. Why don't you go? You go, Vlad. And he went down there and he found Robo, who was the head of the skinheads that we'd been seeing all week long. And I remember Vlad, that 60-something-year-old man, standing in the middle of those young men dressed in skinhead attire, making the case of Jesus Christ in their midst. He had gone from skeptic to evangelist in a matter of a week. Not because of me, but because of the gospel. His obedience to the gospel. His obedience to see the kingdom of God expanded in his own country. The gospel message of Jesus Christ. Folks, listen, there in that chariot, as Philip was listening to the words of this Ethiopian eunuch. Here's what is found in Isaiah 53. Listen to this precious passage. Who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of the dry ground. Listen, this is speaking of Christ. He has no form or comeliness that we should see him. There is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. Listen, church, of our Christ prophesied in the Old Testament. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, and we have esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. Listen to me. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned away everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. Yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before his shearers is silent. He opened not his mouth. That's what the eunuch was reading. No wonder he was saying, who is this man? Who is this man? And Peter said, it is the Christ, the lamb that was slain from the foundations of the world. He could have opened his mouth and called 10,000 angels to come and rescue him. But his mission and his purpose was to come and die. to offer the perfect, sinless life that we were unable to offer, to bring redemption to mankind, which he had promised back in the book of Genesis, which he had promised from the foundation of the world. The kingdom is expanded by our obedience to proclaim, to proclaim, to proclaim. So when it comes by this week, the opportunity to share, and you miss it, or you ignore it, I warned you. It's coming. That chariot might just cruise right past you this week. Catch up to it and proclaim the unsearchable riches into the life of somebody who was once as you in darkness and undone. Thirdly, this, the kingdom is expanded and it produces lasting fruit. Verses 36 through 40, it says this, "Now as they went down the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, 'See, here is water. What hinders me from being baptized?' And Philip said, 'If you believe with all your heart, you may.' And he answered and said, 'I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.' And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he baptized him. Now when they came out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away, so that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went his way rejoicing." The kingdom expanded does produce lasting fruits. This eunuch, this servant of Candace of Ethiopia, went back with a life-changing message of Jesus Christ back to Africa with the gospel, the transforming gospel message, lasting fruits. Where can we find lasting fruits these days, folks? Where can we find anything that has any duration to it at all? At all, like we talked about this morning, changes and turns and halts and falters. But there's something that has lasting fruit. A life transformed by the shed blood of Jesus Christ is a forever lasting fruit. Hallelujah. I remember it was Easter at Midway Baptist Church many years ago, and we had about 20 Wingate students here. And this young lady from, make sure I get this right, where she, remember where she was from, Indonesia. Y'all remember her? Muslim. If you don't remember, I do. Because on Easter, she came to know Christ as Lord and Savior at Midway. Got saved. Got her sins forgiven. Names written in the Lamb's Book of Life, sealed with the Spirit of promise. Got the hope of heaven transformed. Came and sat in my office when she was graduating, getting ready to go home back to Muslim Indonesia. She said, "What do I do? What do I tell my mom and daddy?" And I'll just be honest, I didn't have an answer for her. I could have gave her all kinds of theological reasonings and all kinds of stuff, but what do you tell your mom and daddy? But she went, listen to me, with everlasting fruit. She went with the Spirit of God and a transformed heart. And God will not let His work return void. And if He sent her back to Indonesia to carry the good news of Jesus Christ with her own life, I could have gave her the treaties of the world and it would have done her no good when the Spirit of God does the work that I'm unable to do. And she carried with her lasting fruits. And it was because of this church and its desire to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And those days are still here. They have not gone. It is more imperative now. It is more desirous than it has ever been that we are to be people of the book, of the gospel, of the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ, that we would see the kingdom of God expanded in all the earth. And it doesn't matter who's the president of the United States. Somebody say amen right there. It has never mattered who the president is. Because the gospel was here before this nation was founded, and it will be here after our nation, whatever happens. But the gospel is forever. And the kingdom of God is here. Jesus came, when he came preaching the kingdom of God. There was a pastor stood before his church. It was during a drought. I close with this story. And he held up a piece of paper. He was waving it in front of his folks. It was a citation from the city. What had happened was, because of the drought, they had a moratorium on watering your grass. You couldn't water your grass. So everybody's grass was brown. And the guys that was work for the city, the water department, drove around and made sure your grass wasn't green. If your grass was green, guess what you got? A citation from the city for watering your grass. Well, the grass at the church was brown except for around back. There was a green patch. And that green patch, the guy came to him. He said, listen, I believe you have a broken water line underground. You need to get it fixed. Came back a couple weeks later. He said, sir, your grass is still green. You must have not fixed the water line. Therefore, here is your citation. What the preacher didn't initially tell that city worker was this, was that he started preaching about this couple named Hosea and Gomer. That God told him to go and marry this woman who was a harlot. And they had a couple kids together. And she ran off and she left and left him with the kids. And in his congregation were marriages that were splitting up, people whose lives were turned upside down. It was a mess, kind of like Hosea and Gomer's life. And God told him, go get your wife. She's down in the center of the city. She's on the auction block. She's being sold as a prostitute. Nobody wants her anymore. She's been washed up. She is not even desirous anymore. Go down to the city square and purchase your wife back. And when you get there, you pay in full. You pay in full. And when he went to get his wife and redeem her back, he could have got her for a song. He could have paid pennies on the dollar. But instead, he paid full price for her and in forgiveness redeemed her back to himself as God had commanded. And in doing so, the story of God's redemption through that couple spread through that church with such strength and such power that marriages started getting right and people started getting saved. And what happens when people get saved is you start baptizing some of them. Well, what do you baptize them in, church? Yeah, you said it, water. And what happens after you baptize enough people that you want to change the water? Where does the old water go to? Out back of the church where there's a little green patch of grass that the city workers might think is a busted water line, but it's not. It's just God working and doing his thing in these days and the kingdom of God being expanded into all of the earth. So I challenge you as you move forward in these days to be a people of the book, carry the gospel, carry the kingdom, be a Philip in your world. Amen. Father, thank you for these good people and I ask your richest blessings tonight on all that we do in these coming days. Father, this week I pray that every single person here would see that moment of the Ethiopian in the chariot, in that desert moment, for them to be able to run alongside and at that very place that you have, Lord, to share the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. I pray you'll give them Holy Ghost boldness. I pray you'll give them wisdom and discernment. I pray, Father, for the people that they're going to meet, Lord, that you begin to prepare their hearts to hear the good news. You begin to draw them to yourself, even through the circumstances of their life. And I pray, like this Ethiopian eunuch, that they'll ask, who is this man? Who is this one the Scripture talks about? And that in that moment, Lord, they would speak with the blessings of heaven in their mouths. And Lord, I pray people will be saved because of it, and the baptistry waters will flow in response to it, and that to this place we'd begin to see revival and spiritual awakening in these latter days. We love you, Father. We bless you, and we thank you. And it's in Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you. Go in peace.